Hello viewers, today we'll discuss a story written by Mulkraj Anand. The name of the story is Birth. In this story, the writer Anand depicts the struggles of a poor woman's efforts to make a life for herself and her family. He also illustrates the concept of similes and their use in showing the troubles this woman has to go through. The story further presents a picture of the writer Mulkraj Anand's versatility with words in the telling of this story. In this story, Mulkraj Anand describes the birth of a child. The young mother presented here belongs to the peasant working class. The most striking features of the childbirth are: the birth takes place not in a house or a hospital, but in an open space outside on the roadside. The woman delivers the child all by herself without the help of anyone else. The woman actually is on the way to her daily work as a road mender when she suddenly experiences the labor pains. She delivers the child. Immediately after that, she resumes her walk carrying the infant in her arms and soon joins the others at her workplace for the day. The story is a powerfully realistic presentation of the tough conditions in which the working classes struggle and earn their livelihood. At the same time, it also depicts the remarkable resilience, faith, courage, and strength shown by a poor, downtrodden woman who then becomes representative of her entire class. The story originally was written and published in the year 1947. It can be read as a symbolic representation of the birth of the Indian nation itself, which achieved its independence in the same year. The arrival of the child thus comes to signify a bright hope, not only for her family, as the woman's father-in-law cheerfully declares at the end of the story, but also for the newborn nation. Now, let's learn a bit about the author Mulkraj Anand. Mulkraj Anand was born in the year 1905 and died in the year 2004. He was a major Indian writer in English and is regarded as a pioneer, along with R.K. Narayan and Raja Rao, of Indian fiction in English. He was born in Peshawar, which is now in Pakistan. After graduating from Khalsa College in Amritsar, Anand moved to England, studied at University College London, and did a PhD in philosophy from Cambridge University. While in Britain during the 1930s and 40s, Anand forged friendships with several influential writers such as T.S. Eliot and E.M. Forster. He was also politically active and wrote and spoke championing the cause of independence for India. He had started writing novels even while in Britain, and he continued his prolific literary work after returning to India in 1946. Anand also wrote essays and delivered lectures on matters of cultural and political import. Many of Anand's novels and short stories are about the poor and the downtrodden, for whom he showed greater sympathy as well as admiration. His first major novel, which was published in 1935, was Untouchable, described a day in the life of a young Dalit boy who works as a toilet cleaner and goes through the agony of caste discrimination. Coolie, his second novel, published in 1936 presented the struggle of a boy who goes from hills seeking work in Mumbai and undergoes various forms of oppression in the name of class and caste. Some of his other novels are The Village, published in 1939, The Sword and the Sickle, published in 1942, and The Private Life of an Indian Prince, published in 1953. He planned a series of 7 autobiographical works, of which he completed only 3. One of them, Morning Face, was published in 1968 and won for him the Sahitya Academy Award. Now let's look at the major themes of the present story, Birth. The story Birth mainly depicts the courage, spirit, and determination shown by a poor young woman of a lower caste who musters the strength to deliver her child all by herself, finding that she cannot get help from anyone at the place and time she develops her labor pains. The story also brings out the intensity of love and faith that people of this class are capable of, which helps them to face extremely tough situations and experiences. The story also tells us about the suffering and economic hardship faced by agricultural laborers and small landowners who are unable to earn a livelihood in their own rural soil and are forced to move to urban areas in search of jobs after giving up what little they possess. We also have in the story brief glimpses into the beliefs that often govern the conduct of people in these classes. It may sometimes be a superstitious belief that the arrival of some people brings good luck or bad luck to families. Or it may be the faith in a divine providence or a deity that provides strength and courage at times of crisis or adversity. Even though this story describes the experience of an individual woman giving birth, it may be symbolically interpreted to be about the birth of the Indian nation itself, considering that the story was published in the year 1947, is also the year India got its independence. Now look at the analysis of the story. For the sake of convenience, let's divide the story into 4 parts and analyze them one by one. Part 1. From the beginning of the story to the end of the paragraph, which begins, I quote, all of a quiver, unquote, and ends, quote, through the debt and the drought, unquote. In this introductory portion of the story, we see the major character named Parvati and come to know about the other 2 characters of the story, her husband Ramu and her father-in-law. They have moved from their native village in Ambala to Delhi and working as daily wages laborers. They live in a slum or basti near Karol Bagh and work every day as road menders on Ridge Road. Ramu has already left very early in the morning and Parvati is on her way now after preparing food for them to be taken later. She is accompanied by her father-in-law who is walking ahead of her. Parvati's pregnancy is in a highly advanced stage and even as she is walking with heavy steps, she can feel the first stirrings of labor pain. In this portion, we also come to know the economic background of the family. Parvati's father-in-law, a small farmer, has had a series of misfortunes because of drought and the debts he has had to incur. He has also lost his wife. They had to come to Delhi to earn a livelihood, but even to pay the train fare, he had to mortgage his lands. In the midst of all this suffering, the old man is eagerly awaiting the arrival of his grandson. I quote, "And she, Parvati, had felt ever since that she must justify the old man's faith in her and give him a grandson, if only as a compensation for the loss of his wife and as the only happiness that might compensate him for the slow agony of his ruin through the debt and the drought." Unquote. We also see here the love Parvati bears towards her husband and the strong physical and emotional bond between them. The superstitious belief of the late mother-in-law, who had maintained that it was Parvati who brought bad luck to the family, is also revealed here. Now, let's look at part two of the story. Part two begins with the following text. I quote, "Another tremor of pain and the sickness of bile in the mouth." That's the beginning, I unquote. And the same paragraph ends, I quote, "She stamped the earth," and ends, "the austering in the cauldron of her belly, sizzling and boiling over," unquote. In this part, we see Parvati walking along, though with great difficulty. Her father-in-law is nearly out of sight now, having walked farther away. The path is still dark. The labor pain is intensifying. She feels quite weak, and even her eyesight seems to blur. When she has to pass through a graveyard, she gets a scare, recalling the superstitious stories of horror about, I quote, "the trees of hell," unquote, she had heard from her mother in her childhood. This is how the writer describes the hallucinations, which are apparently unreal images that Parvati sees as she walks through the graveyard, feeling the pain within her stomach. And through this pent-up race between the elements in her belly, the vision of the dull whites of her eyes played havoc with the black points, so that each branch of a tree became the intricate coil of serpents from which hung the skulls of donkeys, stags, lions, elephants, monkeys, side by side with the bodies of the damned. He also employs a simile, which means he compares to describe the pain that Parvati is experiencing. I quote, "The pain in her abdomen became a growl like the noisy motion of a wheel on the road-making engine, and she receded back into the arms of the Dutsa, messengers of the hell," unquote. Part three of the story, which begins, I quote, "Shaking her head in defiance of the demons, both inside and outside her," unquote. And ending with the paragraph which begins, quote, "clutching him with eager, deft hands," and "strode forth towards the ridge to go and break stones," unquote. This passage can be called the central portion of the story, and this is where the birth actually takes place. Parvati realizes the time the baby's arrival is close by. She moves to a hollow ditch by the road, lowers the food basket off her head and falls back on the ditch. Luckily, she doesn't get hurt, but the labor struggle has become more and more intense. She calls out to her mother and God in pain and prayer. She first sits crouching, hardening herself, whipping up her own sides, swaying to and fro. Then she lies down, willing herself into getting the child out. After an hour of struggle and torment, the baby, a boy, arrives. Clutching him with eager, deft hands, she performed the services of the midwife on herself with a cool, assured touch. After cutting the navel strings of which united her child to her with the rough end of the silver hansli round the neck, she emptied the basket in which she carried the food, donated the roti to the birds as a gift offering, put her baby in it, and strode forth towards the ridge to go and break stones, unquote. This part of the story contains a very powerful description of the courage which the woman shows in confronting the struggles and agony of labor pains all by herself. For example, I quote, "Gritting her teeth and hissing till she felt her haunches sagging and her bones twisting, till she could see her frame being pulled by elemental forces which seemed to have come and taken possession of her, the opposite tensions arising from nothing and swaying like a strange and heavy rhythm of the earth's primitive energies," unquote. The imaginary visions come back during this period too, when she cries out to God, but this time they are the benevolent images of deities, Goddess Kali and God Shiva, and also in the skies of an enormous woman lying down flat in the clouds as though she was also on the travail of childbirth. Another interesting feature of this part of the story is Parvati's attitude to her husband. As she is going through the convulsions of labor pain, she feels a sudden wave of resentment that her husband was not by her side. But this feeling is only momentary. She soon curses herself, quote, "for thinking ill of her husband, the lord and master whom our parents had married her off to and whom they expected her to worship." And then she thought of the joy she had had when he had come to her on the night she conceived his child, unquote. The memory of that loving union seems to give her strength and courage. Now, part four of the story. Part four begins, I quote, "The darkness of the twilight was crumbling," unquote. This is the concluding part of the story. It's now bright dawn as Parvati reaches the place where she works, carrying in her arms the basket with the newborn infant in it. The other stone breakers, the woman and the men, including her husband, are amazed at seeing her with the child, awestruck that she has delivered it all by herself. Her father-in-law is pleased and happy to see his grandson and picks him up and puts him to his shoulder. The men and women cannot believe that any ordinary woman could have done what Parvati has. They in fact call her witch and demon. But the father-in-law is not surprised. He says with pride, I quote, "It's no wonder that she had the little one all by herself. She's a peasant woman with strong loins, like many other peasant women of her parts, who have given birth to sons all by themselves, so that our race can be perpetuated and our land tilled for grain," unquote. The passage is significant, as you see, in a number of ways. Firstly, there is the pride in the strength and courage of the peasant class, here especially the woman. Secondly, it seems to be always sons that these women have given birth to all by themselves. This goes with the belief that it's the sons who perpetuate the race. And with the arrival of each child, especially a male child, there is always the hope and confidence that the land will continue to be tilled for grain. It's also a hope for growth and prosperity. It's the newborn male child who represents this hope and confidence. No wonder old man puts aside all his past misery and disappointment and comforts the shrieking child, saying with a gruff tenderness, what did she say? This is what she did. "Come, come, my lion, my stalwart, don't weep and come. It won't be so bad. Come, my son, perhaps with your coming our luck will turn," unquote. That's all about this story, birth. In this lecture, we listen to the themes, characters, and analysis of situations and characters. I hope you enjoyed listening to the story and its analysis.